Good evening. Today I will go bring you through a journey to Antarctica and to talk to you about melting ice and the future of that ice. Antarctica is a continent of superlatives. It is the coldest, the driest, the windiest, the highest, the most isolated continent on Earth. And it contains probably the oldest ice mass that we know. But it's also the biggest ice mass on land. So how big is Antarctica? And therefore, I will guide you through the history of how Antarctica was discovered. Exactly 200 years ago, Antarctica was discovered by von Bellingshausen. He passed very close to the coast, the present coast of Antarctica, and could see the land. He could even discern the mountains. A century before him, Captain James Cook circumnavigated that continent, not once, but several times. But he actually made, by doing this, he actually made the continent smaller. Because previously it was thought that in the south and around the South Pole, there was this huge Terra Australis incognita. And by circumnavigating around it, he made clear that you had a big austral ocean and he couldn't see the continent at all. And therefore he was dubbed as the exponent of negative discovery, but it was an important discovery. We have to wait until the beginning of the 20th century for people to really adventure inside of the Antarctic continent. And in 1911, Roald Amundsen, Norwegian explorer, reached for the first time the South Pole. A couple of weeks later, a British guy, Captain Scott, Robert Falcon Scott, arrived also at the South Pole. It was a real race, but he arrived too late. He was also late on the season, and on the return, they were clearly tired and they also had not enough food. And in fact, the whole expedition, the British expedition, they died. But they left a legacy because Scott also did science on this expedition and assembled a series of rock samples, but also that same expedition during winter collected an emperor penguin egg. An emperor penguin egg that was thought by the biologist Wilson on that expedition that a bird that is breeding in winter must be a very primitive creature. And so this was about the major knowledge we had about the Antarctic continent by 1911, 1912. And you have to put this into perspective. This was only a couple of years before Einstein discovered the theory of general relativity. So basically we knew more about the cosmos than we knew about Antarctica. Research was done and more people visited Antarctica, but it was not until 1957 during the International Geophysical Year that many stations were established on Antarctica and that science has started. By doing measurements on geophysics, on atmosphere, measuring the temperature, and that we gradually knew more and more about it. They also started to sound how thick the ice was. And this continued over the years because these stations were established and continued to operate. And by 1990, we started to have a more or less global view of what the thickness was of the ice, and also what was lying underneath the ice sheet. And this shows a map of our knowledge at that time, showing that you had high plateaus lying more than 1,500 meters above sea level, but also deep basins that were lying below sea level, especially here in the Antarctic, West Antarctic, underneath the West Antarctic ice sheet. So why 1990? Well, in 1990, that was more or less the time that I started my PhD, but also that I went for the first time to Antarctica on a Japanese expedition and spending 4 months on the ice in not always comfortable comfortable environment. So we were spending our time in tents. Basically, these tents were the same as tents as Scott and Amundsen used on their expeditions. So not much has changed. We did measurements of the speed of the flow of the ice, how fast it moves, also how thick it was. And basically, we are not doing things differently today. We are still sleeping in tents. We just have a bit more comfort. We also have more motorized vehicles. But what is still the same between today and in 1990 is that you feel in Antarctica being very tiny in an utterly vast space. The measurements we do to measure ice thickness is using overland traverses, either by skidoo or by bigger vehicles, pulling radars. But more and more, we also use aircraft to do so, with which you can cover larger distances. And if you look at the situation of today, we now have covered almost the whole continent with flight lines here of different colors from different expeditions, showing here how thickness has been measured. There are still some places where not much measurements are around, like for instance, this area is an area of which we don't know much. It's very hard to get there because there are not so many stations around to arrive there. And the result of this is that we now know how thick that ice is, that we have areas where the ice is more than 4 kilometers thick. And underneath that ice, we find mountains, peaks, deep valleys. And some of these valleys are extremely deeply incised by glaciers, several kilometers deep and lying well below sea level. And now we have this global view of Antarctica, of mountain ranges in the center and very large subglacial basins that are lying well below sea level. And especially the West Antarctic ice sheet that you see here, this West Antarctic ice sheet is believed to be a weak area because most of this ice sheet is lying well below sea level. Antarctica is cut up in two by what we call the Transantarctic Mountains, which is this spine that travels through the continent. And this part here we call East Antarctica, and the lower part here we call West Antarctica. This is the ice thickness measured on Mars. And we have a more detailed map of the ice thickness on Mars than we have on Antarctica. Moreover, we have here, these are the Mars South Pole layered deposits. That's the name they give to the ice cap on Mars. And we see here that also a very varying topography, but that is already a map that has been made in 2007. This is more than 10 years ago. And this is thanks to satellites. So a very normal question would be, why don't we use satellites to measure ice thickness on Antarctica? Why are we still pulling sleds behind skidoos? Why are we flying over it in order to measure the thickness? And that is because we have people living on Earth. And if we want to gauge the thickness of the ice from space, we need to use frequencies that could be very harmful for any communication around our planet. On Mars, this is not really the case. But we can use satellites, and there are plenty of satellites that observe actually now how Antarctica is doing. We now have a very clear and detailed view of the topography at the surface of Antarctica with centimeter precision. We can see each snow dune that is formed at the surface, and this thanks to satellites. But these satellites can also measure the flow of Antarctica, how Antarctica is moving. And then we see that we have like large, from the center of the ice sheet, ice is moving towards its periphery. And it's not doing that globally, but it goes through small channels into large ice streams that funnel the flow and concentrate the flow towards the coast. So how big was Antarctica in the past? Because Antarctica probably has never been there all the time. And we also only saw the historical background that Cook made it smaller. But if we go back several millions of years in the past, then we can see that during the Eocene, approximately 50 million years ago, Antarctica was completely ice-free. At that time, the temperature on Earth was also higher. At that time, you also had higher concentrations of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. And it is since the 30 million years ago that the climate started to cool down, also because of a reduced amount of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, that gradually an ice cap started to form, especially in those mountain areas that you have on East Antarctica. But we have to wait until approximately 15 million years ago before we have an ice cap or an ice sheet that covers the complete continent, more or less as it does today. And then after that, at the end of the Pliocene, when into the Pleistocene, so this is the last couple of millions of years, then we see that the ice sheet started to become bigger, but also to become smaller at times. And that was a period that the temperature started to fluctuate on ice. On Earth. Now, as we see here, this is a record of the carbon dioxide in the atmosphere and Antarctic temperature through time over the last 800,000 years. These temperature changes made the ice sheet bigger and smaller, but Antarctica is not only reacting to climate, Antarctica is also an archive of climate. Because these records were retrieved from Antarctica. Every year you have snow falling on the continent. And over the last couple of decades, there have been many drillings in the center of the ice sheet to retrieve what we call an ice core. And thanks to the ice core, its composition, isotopic composition of the ice itself, but also thanks to the presence of little bubbles of air that captured the atmosphere of the past, we can both reconstruct the temperature changes and the changes in atmosphere. And you see clearly that we have the space of higher temperatures, higher CO2, lower temperatures, lower CO2, hand in hand. Now, the reason for these variations during this Pleistocene period are related to orbital changes of the Earth. First of all, you have cycles. The fact that the Earth's orbit around the Sun is either getting more circular or more elliptical. Also, wobbles in the tilt of the axis of the Earth. And all these variations result in small variations in insolation. And they cause these temperatures, but they're not alone there to cause the temperature changes, because we are in a climate system that has a lot of feedbacks. And one of the feedbacks is what was happening on the Northern Hemisphere. Because if we look at what happened during such a glacial period and during a period when it's warmer, what we call an interglacial, then you see that Antarctica gets bigger during a glacial, gets smaller during an interglacial. At some places, parts of this ice sheet are smaller than they are today. But the major changes are in the Northern Hemisphere. And we see that during a glaciation, that we have vast ice sheets that are formed on the North American continent, but also in Scandinavia. And the only remainder of those glacials is the Greenland ice sheet that is still there today And that was there in most of these other interglacial periods in those cycles. So the ice on the Northern Hemisphere played a major role in changing also the climate, because this is a very wide surface that changed the reflectivity of the Earth. So if you have more ice on land, that means that there is less ice in the ocean. And that means that sea level goes down. And that is what happened during those glacial periods. The last glacial maximum, so the last glaciation we knew, that was 20,000 years ago. And sea level was about 120 to 130 meters lower than today. During the Eocene that we have seen 40 million years ago, when there was no ice on Antarctica, there was hardly any ice on Earth. And sea level was more than 60, 70 meters higher. And you see that if you connect all these dots between the last glacial maximum today, the Pliocene and the Eocene, that you have like a relationship between sea level and global mean temperature of the Earth. And that 1 degree of sea level, 1 degree of temperature change means 20 meters of sea level change. And there is a little issue. Because if you look at, for instance, an IPCC report that looks at what will sea level do at the end of this century, well, for a strong warming climate where the temperature is 3 degrees higher as today, well, we would expect to have approximately 1 meter of sea level rise and not 60 meters of sea level rise. And so to explain that, this will happen in the next sections. So I will start with an interlude on the physics of ice in order to understand how ice is behaving. It makes you basically a glaciologist, and it's a glaciology course 101. Ice is a solid, we know that. If we take a sample of water, we put it in the freezer, it will freeze over and it freezes rock solid, and that is a solid. But if you have loads of ice behaves like a fluid. Because in reality, ice is a viscoplastic material. That means that if you have a small amount of it, or if you have very low stresses exerting on the ice, then it will not deform. It will behave as a solid. On the contrary, if you have put a lot of stress on the ice, a lot of weight, if you have like several kilometers thick of ice, well, this ice will deform and will behave more like a plastic. And in between, you have this viscous behavior. And this is shown here in this figure, where C shows how the deformation rate of ice changes with applied stress. So that's completely non-linear. It's not plastic, it's not viscous, it is viscoplastic. But there is another reason why this is viscoplastic, and it's because ice in ice sheets is not frozen water. It is an accumulation of snow, compacted snow. And that is a major difference, because each snowflake is a crystal. And the accumulation of all these crystals forms a compaction of crystals of several particles that are apart, and that can slide under the weight, move one next to each other. Very small movements. These are movements of an angström, if you apply a certain stress on this. But the accumulation of all these tiny movements gives you a deformation that is visible. And that is the reason why glaciers flow, why they move. So every year you have accumulation of snow at the surface, and that material deforms and is transported towards the edges. And due to this transport, it gives us a dome-shaped form of an ice sheet. So the ice sheet is the thickest in the center, and it becomes thinner and thinner towards the edge. Now, in the center of an ice sheet, knowing that it is very thick, it's also very high. And the higher you go, the lower the temperature. So lower temperatures means that you have solid precipitation, snow. But if you go to lower altitudes, then you also may have melt. So you may have areas where the ice starts to melt. And an ice sheet like Greenland or a glacier that you visit in the Alps, you have a balance between the amount of solid precipitation that falls on it and the amount of melt on a yearly basis. And a glacier is therefore in an equilibrium state whenever you balance the input with the output. Now for the Antarctic, the situation is slightly different because you don't have so high temperatures. Basically, even in coastal areas, the mean annual temperature is well below zero. So that means when the ice comes to the coast, it comes in contact with the ocean. And instead of melting, well, since it's thin enough, it starts to float due to the buoyancy forces of the ocean that pushes the ice up and it starts to float. And that forms then platforms that we call ice shelves. And it is from those ice shelves that pieces break off and that we call icebergs. So icebergs are the result of the contact of an ice mass with the ocean. If you don't have icebergs, that means that the contact is on the land and the balance is made essentially by melting. But also the dynamics are different for these different types in the different regions in the ice sheet. In the center of the ice sheet, we have gravity that will deform the ice. The fact that we have this weight of kilometers thick ice and gravity that pulls this to the center of the Earth. Of course, the Earth is there to prevent it, so it needs to move around it or on top of it. And so in the center, ice is mostly frozen and the deformation increases with elevation. So you get the maximum velocity or the maximum speed of the ice at the surface of the ice. But when this ice flows towards the lower region, it also warms up. It warms because it comes into a warmer area, but it also warms because of frictional heating that is released. And then it produces a water layer underneath, between the rock and the ice. And we know what a water layer does with ice. You start to slide. And so you get a kind of sliding that is added to it, and that makes that these ice streams, as we call them, move so fast. And as we saw in the animation previously of the velocity, that is where all this converging flow goes into those deep troughs that are warm-based and where the ice starts to speed up. And then it comes into the ocean. And in the ocean, there the situation is completely different. Because at the ocean, you don't have friction with the water. So the ice comes in the water and it starts to stretch. And the only balance that exists is the pressure of the seawater at the edge that prevents it from spreading further. The spreading is typically the same as if you take a drop of oil and you put it in water. This oil will spread evenly in all directions. Well, here, the ice, when it arrives in the water, it will also spread, but in the direction of the ocean. And the rate of spreading will be balanced by the pressure that is given by the ocean. Now, an area that is very interesting is the contact between the grounded ice sheet that is resting on the bed, and the ice that is floating. And that we call the grounding line. So I have been studying grounding lines and dynamics of grounding lines since PhD time. And that's why I was so happy when for the first time in Antarctica, I could visit a grounding line. So here you see me standing, very happy face, on a grounding line, the junction between the grounded ice sheet and the floating ice shelf. And as you see from the picture, there is not much to see. It's just a vast empty area. The only way to see this junction a bit is to ride across it with a skidoo and measure the elevation. And that is what this graph to the right is showing. It shows this abrupt change of a slope between the grounded ice sheet that has a steep slope and the flat ice shelf. It's also a dangerous area. I also managed to not only stand on a grounding line, but also to sleep on a grounding line. Maybe that was not the most wise idea to do so, because of these buoyancy forces and the tides, these ice shelves move up and down while the ice flows in from the inland. And that means that you have a lot of cracks. And these cracks form crevasses. And here you see this picture, and that's clearly not me. I think that I am lying in the tent. And so it's a quite dangerous area to adventure. So, but why so much importance for these grounding lines and these ice shelves? Well, ice shelves are not, it's not a party, an ice shelf. Ice shelves are is the cork on this bottle. And the bottle is, or the liquid in the bottle, is the grounded ice of the Antarctic ice sheet. What does that mean? Well, as long as the ice shelf is sitting there, it keeps the ice in place. It prevents the grounded ice to move too fast, even in those ice streams. But when you remove the cork, when you remove the ice shelf, ice will start to speed up. That means that more of the ice that is stored on the inland will be transported towards the ocean. And when that happens, that raises sea level. Now we can determine this, how strong this effect is. And this is shown here in the colors on this figure. So all the blue colors show, in fact, a very weak buttressing, because that is the effect, it's the stress that is exerted by the ice shelf to keep the upstream ice in place. So there it is, has no effect. It means that if in those blue areas an iceberg breaks off, it will not affect the flow of the ice of the ice sheet. However, when in those warmer colors you get the surface of the Earth, we can measure where things are changing. And even though this is a very short record from the beginning of the 2000s to today, we see that the ice, we get in a majority an ice loss of Antarctica, but this loss is concentrated. And this concentration is here. It is concentrated in West Antarctica, and especially around two glaciers that are situated here, which are called Pine Island Glacier and Thwaites Glacier. And the reason why they start to reduce so much in size is related to a number of facts. First of all, the left figure shows the amount of melting that is happening underneath these ice shelves. So this is due to the ocean. And then you see that where we have the largest changes in mass of the Antarctic ice sheet is where those ice shelves, those corks on the bottle, are getting looser. And so liquid can escape. And this is not happening everywhere. This is especially around this Amundsen-Bellingshausen Sea, that same area where we see the mass loss. And the figure to the right shows clearly that it corresponds also, that this corresponds also to, that this corresponds also to, warmer ocean water in that area. I have a little problem here. Okay. So where is that warm water coming from? Well, that warm water is what we call circumpolar deep water. It's water that is salty and slightly warmer than the cold Antarctic waters, but that is running around the Antarctic continent. And that in that area is pushed up the continental shelf and reaches underneath the ice shelves to the famous grounding line and starts to melt the ice shelves from underneath. So these ice shelves get thinner, and the fact that they are getting thinner, you get a retreat of the grounding line, or in other words, you get also an increased mass loss of inland ice. And this is a little schematic of Pine Island Glacier. But it's not only the ocean that works on this. You have also on some ice shelves the effect of surface water, meltwater. So even though we have very low temperatures, the fact that we have winds on Antarctica, that's also energy. And this energy is used to heat up the air and the contact with the ice, and then you get surface meltwater. And these surface meltwater streams can be very large, as shown here in Antarctica, even though the temperature is well below sea level. And they can also disappear within the ice shelf. So some colleagues drilled into the ice shelf and found that there was water in the bottom of this drill hole. They lowered in a camera. And as this camera goes down in that borehole, you see clearly here the ice on the borders. You see these bubbles in the ice that I talked about in the beginning. Well, underneath 4 meters of ice, they found this enormous, huge water lake that was sitting there on top of this ice shelf. So having such an amount of water will also play a role in the dynamics of ice shelves and the way ice shelves can more or less disintegrate. So what is now the future for the Antarctic ice sheet? Well, in the 1970s, John Mercer wrote a paper in Nature with the title West Antarctic Ice Sheet and CO2 Greenhouse Effect, a Threat of Disaster. Now, for those that think that global warming is something that only emerged or a couple of years ago, this is in the mid of the 1970s. Global warming is something that scientists know already for a long time. But this paper is more looking at what global warming does to the Antarctic ice sheet. And this shows that with the warming of 5 to 10 degrees, the whole West Antarctic ice sheet can disintegrate and disappear. Although there was not much proof for that, but the principle behind this was what we call the marine ice sheet instability. What does that mean? Well, the West Antarctic ice sheet is lying on in a subglacial basin that is the deepest in the center of the ice sheet. That means that the slope from the grounding line towards the center of the ice sheet decreases, as we can see in this figure. That's what we call a retrograde slope. So if you start to melt on these ice shelves so that they become thinner and the cork gets weaker, then you get a more outflow. If you get more outflow of grounded ice, then the ice gets, that grounded ice gets thinner, of course, but it also gets closer to flotation, meaning that the grounding line will retreat further. But there the grounding line comes into a deeper section because the slope of the bed goes deeper. So meaning that it will thin even further because the flux increases, and so on and so on. And this is an unstoppable process until you reach a bed that goes in the other direction. But since the center of the ice sheet is the deepest point, it means that the whole ice sheet disintegrates. So I have here a schematic that shows it how we now can put this in computer models, this mechanism on how over these deepened portions of an ice sheet, this gets unstable. Of course, this only works when your ice shelf completely disintegrates, or your ice shelf, the cork is completely removed. In reality, if you have a bigger outflow of ice, you get also a bigger outflow into ice shelves and formation of ice shelves. So here you see an example on Thwaites Glacier. So how fast such a marine ice stability, ice sheet instability can happen. We recently did an experiment on this with several ice sheet models that were developed all over the world. And by saying what would happen to the Antarctic ice sheet if we remove all the corks on the bottles, because Antarctica has a lot of ice shelves, a lot of corks. And if we pull them all out simultaneously, what will happen? Well, this is what would happen according to all those models in a tiny space of 500 years. And you see that all those models predict that the West Antarctic ice sheet disappears. Time is not given here, but most of them result in a loss of the West Antarctic ice sheet in less than 100 years. But this is, of course, on when you remove completely the corks. So in order to have a more realistic experiment, you need to define how the atmosphere and the ocean is going to influence the melting of ice shelves. And we cannot predict with precision what the climate will do, because that depends on what mankind will do. It will depend on how much CO2 we will further emit in the atmosphere or not emit in the atmosphere. And therefore, we have a number of scenarios that we can use. For instance, the scenario RCP 2.6 is a scenario that was used for the Paris Agreement in order to keep the temperature, global mean temperature, below plus 2 degrees compared to pre-industrial times. There was a reason for this, and the reason will be shown later. And then we have another scenario, and I take the other end member of the series. It's the RCP 8.5, and that is a so-called business as usual scenario. If we just keep emitting CO2 the way we are doing. So you see here the scenarios, they normally go until 2100. Here you see how they are extended until 2300. But the result, and I will now show you an experiment on Antarctica that goes several centuries further, based on this extreme scenario of business as usual. So here you see two things from the historical record to the future. It's to the left, the change in ice thickness, and to the right, the change in ocean temperature. And so you see how rapidly that the West Antarctic ice sheet over a century potentially can disintegrate, but not only the West Antarctic ice sheet, also areas in East Antarctica can also lead to major contributions to sea level. Meaning that you can get over several centuries a multimeter sea level rise. So to conclude, what happens in Antarctica doesn't stay in Antarctica. So this is what the Antarctic ice sheet currently is doing over the last couple of decades. These are reconstructions of the present balance of mass of the Antarctic ice sheet. And you see that the East Antarctic ice sheet is more or less in balance. You see that over the last 20 years, you had a slight increase in mass related to an increase in precipitation. But these are tiny increases in precipitation. But since it's such a huge continent, this has immediately an impact. But we see that the dominant signal is a signal from West Antarctica, where we have that mass loss essentially in Pine Island and Thwaites glaciers. And you see that this contribution over that period, it's less than 1 centimeter over this 20-year period. To put this into perspective, well, Antarctica is not the sole ice mass on Earth. And I just wanted only to talk about Antarctica, not to make it too complicated. So Antarctica is, compared to Greenland, contributing today less than Greenland to global sea level rise. But Greenland, Antarctica, and all glaciers on Earth, they account for more than half the complete contribution to sea level. The other part, which is a bit more than a third, is steric contribution, and that is the expansion of the ocean because the surface of the ocean is warming. So if you warm a fluid, it will expand. This circle here shows the global rate of sea level rise, which is today more than 3 millimeters per year. That means above 30 to 35 centimeters per century. So what will happen now in the future? Well, according to different ice sheet models and glacier models that we can use, we can predict according to those scenarios, the RCP 2.6, that's the Paris Agreement, and the RCP 8.5, that is the extreme scenario, we can predict what these ice masses will do. And you see that, yeah, they will just continue to lose mass, but they will do so in an accelerating way. Greenland and glaciers, they become smaller, and as they become smaller, they also become warmer and they get more and more melt. That is one story. The same is, it's not the same for Antarctica. Antarctica gets smaller because warmer water of the ocean creates more and more retreat of the grounding line and more mass discharged into the ocean. But the message here is what is happening after 2100. And there we have the major changes. And those major changes are essentially pertaining to the Antarctic ice sheet. Because the question is not if a marine ice sheet instability will occur, the question is when it will occur. And it's most likely that it will not occur this century, even for more higher scenarios, but much more likely in the century that follows. And then you can lead, as it's shown here, it can lead to multimeter sea level rise. Now, it can happen earlier, and it can happen earlier if we get more certainty on the processes that are occurring. So I have been talking all the time about Antarctica, but we are living in Europe, and Europe is very far away from Antarctica. What happens in Antarctica? Will it stay in Antarctica? And the answer is no. Because if you have a loss of mass in Antarctica, it changes the gravity field of the Earth. And you have to know that sea level follows that gravity field. And if you have a reduction of mass at one place, that lowers the sea level locally. But that addition of mass from Antarctica into the ocean goes elsewhere. And so what melts in Antarctica lowers the sea level around Antarctica, but increases the sea level more than the mean sea level in the Northern Hemisphere. And vice versa, if we have mass loss from Greenland, then it lowers the sea level around Greenland, as can be seen in this figure, but it will also increase it in the Southern Hemisphere. And since the largest uncertainties and the biggest potential contribution to sea level is from Antarctica, it will have a major impact for the Northern Hemisphere. But we don't need to wait until that happens, because things are already happening now and are already influencing coastal areas, because most of the coastal areas are highly densely populated areas on Earth. You have most of the economic activities take place in those areas. And even under a very mitigated scenario as an RCP 2.6, you have an increase of extreme events and impacts that already require a necessary adaptation to coastal infrastructures around the world. The fact is that, of course, this gets more important when we are dealing with an RCP 8.5, with a business as usual. So even though rising sea levels will require adaptations that are ongoing, and sea level will always rise, but slowly if we take a mitigated scenario, more dramatic events cannot be excluded with these high scenarios of business as usual, and that on timescales, human timescales, of a century or a century and a half. So the future of Antarctica is uncertain, but it has certainties, and the certainties are that it will continue to contribute to sea level rise, and it will accelerate to contribute to sea level rise, as does all the other ice masses do. But we can limit dramatic events. We can limit so-called tipping points when a huge amount of ice, a destabilization of parts of Antarctica could happen. Just to give you an idea, the West Antarctic ice sheet, a collapse of that, is more than 3 meters of sea level. And if you add to that also submarine basins in East Antarctica, that would go beyond those 3 meters, and that can really be multi-meter up to 10 meters of sea level, but that over several centuries. So this multi-meter sea level rise is likely for high increases in temperature. It's less likely for stabilized scenarios in which we mitigate a lot. But the timing of the events will very much depend on the amount of temperature rise that we allow for. So this is the end of the talk. I hope you enjoyed it. Thank you very much.